Welcome to the Avengers video game. Choose your character. The cool, smart hero made of metal. The leader, a man out of time. The spy, the infiltrator. The strong guy. The archer. Cut.
Who was this guy again? Thor? Like, the Norse god? What does he do? He's there? Ooh, that can't be right. Okay, so that may have been a bit harsh, but was it wrong? I don't think so. Hear me out. We all know who Thor is, right? He's one of the big three, of course we do. He's a powerful Asgardian who uses his magical hammer, Mjolnir, and his powers of thunder and lightning to defeat his enemies. He's also an Avenger, working alongside Iron Man, Captain America, and many others in order to protect the Earth from world-ending threats. But what if I told you that, while Thor has been a part of the Avengers team ever since its inception, he wasn't a real Avenger until Thor Ragnarok? What if I told you that the Thor we first meet in the Marvel Cinematic Universe and the Thor we have seen since Ragnarok are two entirely different characters, with the first version of the character never providing anything significant to the Avengers, while the second iteration has become an irreplaceable part of Earth's mightiest team?
Awesome. Eggs? Breakfast?
No, I'd like a Bloody Mary.
Now, don't get me wrong, there is nothing wrong with the first version of Thor. He's a well-written, interesting enough character with unique traits and a simple, straightforward personal arc. However, as an Avenger, the character fades into the background, overshadowed by other Avengers who embody Thor's unique aspects better than he does. Strength, perplexity, worthiness, these are all unique traits that are taken from Thor whenever he's part of the Avengers. Which is where Thor Ragnarok comes in. The third installment in the Thor franchise completely reinvented the God of Thunder, creating a new, compelling character that could stand on his own and stand out amongst the other Avengers. What did Thor Ragnarok change? Let's take a look and find out.
Loki is beyond reason, but he is of Asgard, and he is my brother.
He killed 80 people in 2 days.
He's adopted.
Before we can look at what Thor Ragnarok changed, and how it created a completely different version of Thor that is irreplaceable as an Avenger, we must first look at the original Thor, and see how this character failed to stand out as part of Earth's mightiest team. When we first meet Thor, he's a war-hungry, reckless Asgardian that is eager to fight and become the rightful king of Asgard. Or, as his father puts it, he's...
not a vain, greedy, cruel boy!
The character and his journey is very Herculean in nature. Thor must undergo a quest and overcome various challenges in order to become wiser and better as a person. By the end of the first movie, the God of Thunder proves he's still worthy of wielding Mjolnir. He becomes wiser and more peaceful, acknowledging that he has a lot to learn before becoming King of Asgard, and sacrificing his own happiness in order to protect a race that he would have waged war upon at the beginning of the movie. In Thor's own words,
"You could have killed them all with your bare hands."
I changed.
And by the end of Thor, the Dark World, our protagonist no longer wants to be a king, he just wants to be a good man, protecting the Nine Realms for the rest of his life. Now, let's take this Thor and see how he does as part of the Avengers. Well, as it turns out, not so great. All the unique aspects of the character become meaningless, as the other Avengers embody those aspects better than the mighty Asgardian. During the first Avengers movie, Thor has three main characteristics. He's incredibly powerful, he's an alien on Earth, and he's an Asgardian. Unfortunately, these characteristics are not as prominent in Thor as they are in other characters. Thor may be incredibly powerful, but he's not as strong as the Hulk. And while he may be an alien on Earth, he's not as much of an alien as the man out of time, Steve Rogers.
Monkeys. I do not understand.
I do. I understood that reference.
Now, that's not a significant problem. There are plenty of characters out there that are incredibly strong, or that don't quite fit in or fully understand what's going on. The significant problem is that Thor's remaining characteristic, that of being an Asgardian, doesn't sufficiently distinguish him from the other characters, making him redundant when surrounded by the other Avengers. What's worse is when you consider the reason Thor is a part of this movie. Thor's presence is not the result of his unique character, his personality, or his abilities. It's the result of his personal connection to the movie's villain, Loki. Had Thor been replaced by any other Asgardian or any other character that shared a history with Loki, the first Avengers movie would not have been much different. But what about Mjolnir? Thor may not be the strongest or the most confused Avenger, but at least he's the only one that can wield this magical hammer. After all, Mjolnir is emphasized so much in any movie that Thor is in that it ends up sounding like...
Sounds like you had a pretty special and intimate relationship with this hammer, and that losing it was almost comparable to losing a loved one.
It's a nice way of putting it.
Which is where Age of Ultron comes in.
So my friend here pushed me in front of a moving car. No big deal.
Ladies and gentlemen of the court, these were dire times and dire actions were needed.
If the first Avengers movie began the process of removing Thor's unique qualities, Age of Ultron finished the job. After once more emphasizing the importance of Mjolnir as Thor's unique weapon...
You're all not worthy.
Age of Ultron pulls an M. Night Himalayan as Vision grabs the mighty hammer and hands it to Thor. He even uses it against Ultron before telling Thor...
It's terribly well balanced.
Well, if there's too much weight, you lose power on the swings.
By having another character capable of wielding Thor's unique weapon, Age of Ultron strips away the last unique aspect of Thor, rendering him replaceable, his traits now homogenized amongst the other Avengers. So, while this version of Thor is a brilliant, well-written, and unique character on his own, he fades into obscurity when he's with the other Avengers. No longer is he the most powerful Avenger or the confused fish out of water. No longer is he the only one that can wield Mjolnir. Deprived of every single thing that makes him unique, Thor becomes less important and relevant than even Hawkeye, who at least has a unique gimmick. I don't see any other Avenger shooting arrows, do you?
Hi, coming to you.
Keep up, old man.
Nobody would know. Nobody.
All of that changes with Thor Ragnarok. Let me show you how. Thor Ragnarok created a new and improved Thor in just 3 steps. These are changing the mood and style of the movie, looking at Thor as a member of a team, and reconstructing who Thor is as a character. The first step was truly the most critical, as it laid the foundation upon which all of the other steps took place. It was through this pivotal step that Thor and his movies stopped being generic and started being unique. In terms of style, Thor Ragnarok surprised audiences by going in an entirely different direction than its predecessors. While Thor and Thor the Dark World were generic in style, mixing modernity and fantasy on a desaturated and bland canvas, Ragnarok opted for a retro 80s futuristic style. Not only was this style vibrant and electric, with bright colors and bold designs, but it was also unique, setting the movie and its protagonist apart from all other MCU movies. I mean, the credits alone were a spectacle to look at. Look at this, this is beautiful. The change in style was, of course, accompanied by a change in mood. Departing from the previous movies, which were dark and serious action pieces, Thor Ragnarok had a more comedic take on the adventures and tragedies experienced by our hero. The beginning of the movie signals this perfectly, when instead of an intense battle scene, we get this.
Then you have seen Ragnarok, the fall of Asgard, the great prophecy.
Hang on. I mean, back around shortly. Do I really feel like we were connecting there?
Yeah. Okay, so Ragnarok, tell me about that. Walk me through it.
Not only did the changes in style and mood support one another, but they also supported the following 2 steps, which led to an iconic character being born. The second step was looking at Thor as part of a team from the very beginning. Remember when we said that Thor's unique aspects were overshadowed by the other Avengers? With the Hulk being stronger, Captain America being more confused, and Vision being capable of wielding Mjolnir? That was the unintended consequence of ignoring what each member of the Avengers could bring to the table. When reinventing Thor, Ragnarok showed us what the Asgardian could provide to a team by having the God of Thunder lead one of his own, the Revengers.
Revenges?
Because I'm getting revenge. You're getting revenge, and you want revenge?
I'm undecided.
Okay.
What could Thor provide? Comedic relief.
That's what. Because that's what heroes do.
Also, by including the Hulk and Bruce Banner, the movie reasserted Thor's membership as an Avenger, before making us question whether the green guy really is the strongest Avenger.
Banner.
Welcome, strongest Avenger.
What?
But by the end of the movie, Thor's strength is no longer questioned, nor is it relevant. Thor Odinson is not meant to be the strong guy. He's the funny guy, the social chameleon that can fit into any group because of the comedic relief he provides as a character. It doesn't matter if any Avenger is stronger, more confused, or more worthy than Thor, because they won't be able to deprive the character of his comedic value. Speaking of Thor's comedic value, let's take a look at how Ragnarok reconstructed the God of Thunder into an entirely different and unique character. The third step achieved this through a variety of means, but at its core, it made it clear that Thor was not the God of Hammers. Throughout the movie, Thor's reliance upon Mjolnir gradually decreased, leading to an intrinsic sense of power and self-worth. First, Mjolnir was destroyed. Then, Thor's relationship with the godly weapon was addressed and promptly ridiculed. Following that, Thor used other weapons in combat, only to eventually realize he didn't need Mjolnir in order to achieve his true potential. It no longer mattered that Vision could also wield Mjolnir because Thor's power and feelings of self-worth were no longer tied to the magical hammer. But Thor's reliance upon Mjolnir was not the only thing that changed regarding the character. The change in hairstyle, armor, and number of eyes all served to further separate the Asgardian from his previous iteration. Finally, Thor had been elevated from the status of alien to that of the God of Thunder, gracing us with one of the best scenes in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Thor now looked differently, behaved differently, and played a unique role in group dynamics. What once had been an arrogant warrior was now a king. An awkward, funny, reluctant king with a child's innocence, but a king nonetheless. The best part? All of these changes stuck with Thor in the upcoming movies. Take Thor's relationship with Mjolnir, for instance. The distance between the two further increases as Thor goes on a quest to forge a weapon capable of killing Thanos. And even after retrieving an old Mjolnir, Thor casually tosses it to Steve, saying,
No, give me that. You have the little one.
Also, the Asgardian proves his versatility and charm as a team member by interacting with both the Guardians of the Galaxy and the Avengers. Most importantly, while Thor has a lot of heartfelt moments, he remains the character that provides the audience with much-needed comedic relief in otherwise dark and serious scenarios. Now that we have looked at both versions of Thor, let's use the Bifrost and find out what this means for the character and his role as an Avenger. As we can see, the Thor before and after Ragnarok are two completely different characters, with entirely different personalities and roles within the story. While the previous Thor being replaced by any other character would not have affected the audience's experience, getting rid of the current Thor in movies such as Infinity War and Endgame would have deprived us of intense and meaningful moments as well as valuable comedic relief. This Thor and this Thor are not the same. You might be wondering, why does any of this matter? Well, if a story is structured around a group of characters, each character must have a unique personality and serve a specific purpose in the story. Otherwise, if those characters don't have archetypal roles established, there's a big chance that they'll be seen as boring, redundant, or replaceable, which was precisely the position Thor was in before being reinvented. Now, Thor may not be as good of a leader as Captain America, as cool as Iron Man, or as strong as the Hulk, but for an alien, he certainly is one of the funniest, most relatable heroes that I have ever seen, which is why he's my favorite Avenger.
I knew it.
Now, I have a question for you. Do you think Thor had a unique role as part of the Avengers before Ragnarok? If so, what was that role? Also, which Thor do you prefer? The one before or after Ragnarok? Let us know in the comments section below. As always, thank you for watching. Keep writing. Hey, you made it to the end. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed the video, remember to like, comment, and subscribe. It helps the channel more than you know. If we reach 1,000 views and 200 likes, I'll start working on another Marvel video. Our Patreon supporters also get to suggest and vote on upcoming video ideas and decide which videos get produced first. If you want to, give it a look, it's pretty cool.